Hello everyone.
Welcome to LLB school lecture. Today will be the today's sessions will be handled by Dr. Rajas Rao. So in continuation to the last session, he will be showing us how to prepare the system and steps involved in molecular dynamic simulation. So he will be taking care of this session completely. So moving on to Rajas. Rajas, you can take over.
Yeah. Thank you for now. In continuation from taking off from where we left off in the last session. So in the last session, we discussed about what are the essential theories related to the molecular dynamics simulations. So today we will, I'll be showing you how to prepare for the molecular dynamic simulations. So before you do any molecular dynamic simulations, you need, there are certain amount of preparation steps to be done. In my last presentation, I just showed this slide. This slide just summarizes the steps involved in preparation for an MD simulation. So you don't just start an MD simulation with just a PDB file. So there are certain preparation steps you need to do. So the first step is you take a protein PDB file, you clean the protein and you put it in a simulation box, and then you add water molecules and ion molecules to this simulation box. And then once you're done with that, you perform energy minimization, and after that you'll have to equilibrate the system. And once you're done with the equilibration, you move on to the production. Then you can do the actual simulation. So I'll explain in detail what are each of these steps in further slides. So to prepare the system, first we need a PDB file of the protein we would like to do simulation on. So for that, you can download the protein PDB file from the PDB website, where you can search for the protein ID. So in this tutorial, in this session, we'll try this on PDB structure of a hen egg white lysozyme. Its PDB ID is 1AKI. So you can download it from PDB website, or you can also try it from. Just a moment. So you can also try to do the same thing using Pymol or Chimera. So I'll just show you how to do that using Pymol. I'll stop sharing now and I'll try to show it using the Pymol.
You can share your screen, Rajas. That will be, I think, as a whole. So
I think to share for the Pymol, first I need to disconnect the
no. You can do one thing, like click share content.
Just a second. Okay, so is it visible now?
Yes, it's visible. The screen is visible. Pymol.
So without going to the PDB website, you can also download the PDB structure directly from Pymol. So what you have to do is you have to type the command fetch space the PDB ID. So in this case, fetch 1AKI. And it will download the PDB structure automatically. So you can see that you have the protein we want to do the simulation on right here. But apart from that, you can see there are a lot of smaller red dots. They are all the non-protein atoms. So that's what I meant when I said cleaning the PDB structure. We need to make sure that when we are starting with a PDB structure, it contains only the protein. It should not contain any other non-protein particle which may interfere with the simulation. So for that, I'll switch on the sequence. So there's a S button at the bottom of the PyMOL interface. So just press the S button and it shows the sequence. So you can see the protein sequence here. And apart from the protein, you can see other sequence of other particles as well. So these are actually water molecules. They are solved in the PDB structure as well. They are solved in the crystal structure along with the protein as well. So these are all, it will be interesting to look at the water molecules, but for now we'll just delete all these water molecules. We just need a clean protein file. So I'll choose all the water molecules. I'll right click on that and I'll press remove, and it will remove all the water molecules. And then once you have the clean protein file, we need to go to file and you need to press export molecule. Go to PDB options and retain IDs, I guess. And press all. Save. So, and then you can save the PDB structure as a starting point. So in my case, I already have a PDB structure here, so which I'll be using this as a starting point.
Rajas?
Yeah.
There is a question, like how do you select water molecules?
Okay.
I'll
show it to you once again.
Can you show the fetch also? Like the command line is so small, the font, so can you maximize and show? Yeah.
It's also shown in the presentation. I'm zooming it into the part where it's visible.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
So you can either at the end of the at the bottom of the PyMOL screen, there's a command line. So there you can type fetch space 1 AKI and press enter. It will download the structure for you. So to select the water molecules, you need to press button. It will show the sequence, so you have all the sequences, and then press selecting chains. Press on the selecting residues, it will change to chains. So when there's when it shows selecting chains, that means it selects all the molecule. So if you can move on to the water part and just click on it, and it will select all the water molecules. So for example, I want to select the protein chain here. So I'll just click on the protein sequence, it will select all the protein chain. In the same way, you can do the same thing on the water molecule as well. So you can click on the water molecules. You can left click on the water molecules. It will select all the water molecules. And once you have selected all the water molecules, right click on that and press. So let's say you selected everything, then right click on it, there will be an option called remove in the end. So once you press remove, all the water molecules will be removed. Next thing we need to do is, so we have a PDB file, we need to choose a force field. So I've explained what are the concept of force field in my previous lecture. So to do that, so I'll just navigate to the directory. I hope everyone has installed Gromax in their systems. If it's not installed, then it's not a problem. You can just watch this tutorial and you can try it on your own later. So you need to open the terminal and you need to go to the directory where your PDB file is located. So once you navigate to that directory, you need to type, you need to make sure the Gromax is loaded. So to load that, you need to type this command source /user/local/gromax/bin/gmxrc. So once you type that, it will load the Gromax. In some cases, there's no need to do that. It depends on which version you're using. In some cases, you need to do that. In others, there's no need to do that. But once you've loaded the Gromax, you have to type a command, gmx space pdb to gmx dash f 1aki0.pdb. So I had, after cleaning the pdb, I had saved the pdb as 1aki0.pdb. So that's the clean pdb file I'm choosing, dash f options. So apart from that dash, I'll sell dash o 1aki hyphen protein dot grow, and I'll add one more option called water. So I'll type SPCE. So when I say dash water, that means I'm telling it to choose this particular water model. So when I say SPCE, I'm telling it to choose the SPC water model. So I'll give this command and I'll press enter. So when I press enter, it will give me a prompt showing what sort of force field I need to choose. So it's like a once you go to a restaurant, you'll see a menu. So there are different dishes available in the menu. So in the same way, it will give a list of force fields and it asks you to choose one particular force field. So it depends on which force field will be more appropriate for your system and so on. But in this case, for the tutorial, we'll choose OPLS force field, which is number 15. So I'll type 15 and press enter. So it will, I have chosen the OPLS force field and it will create the topology file for the protein. So in the topology file, it will give all the details of the interactions. So it will give all the details of the protein and the all the details about the interactions and so on. Interactions in the same bonded as well as non-bonded interactions. So once you have done with this step, I hope everyone is able to follow now. If not, I'll be moving to the next step. If someone is having difficulty in following, you can just let me know or interrupt me. So I'll explain it once again. So once we have do the PDB to GMX step, it does two things. One is it creates an input coordinate file. So like there's a PDB coordinate file, in the same way Gromax uses its own coordinate format. It's called .grow file. So in PDB to GMX command, I had given 1aki protein.grow. So we'll just have a look at that grow file. So this is the grow file. So I'll just open it using a text editor and I'll show it to you what is present inside that grow file. So you can see that at the first line of the grow file, there's a title of the file. It can be anything. The title can be given anything. It's just a string. And in the second line, there's a number. So this number shows you how many atoms are present in this particular coordinate file. So here it's showing 1960. That means there are 1960 atoms. And after that, there are list of atoms. So you can see that there are a few similarities with the PDB file. So I'll show you what do each column mean. So first column shows the residue number as well as the name of the residue. LYS means lysine, valine, and so on. It's the three-letter code of the residue. So in the second atom, in the second column, it shows the name of the atom. So for instance, in line 3, it's N, which means nitrogen. In line 4, it's H1, which is hydrogen. In line 7, it's CA, which is the C alpha atom. In line 9, it's CB, which means the C beta atom, and so on. And in the third column, it's the atom number. So you can see that it starts from 1 and goes goes on till the end. So third column is the atom number. Fourth column is the x coordinate of the particular atom. So fourth, fifth, and sixth columns are just x, y, z coordinates where you can see all the details about the x, y, z coordinates of every atom of the particular structure file. So it's just that it's quite simple. And if we go to the end of the file, we'll find something else. So we can find three set of numbers. So each of these number shows the dimension of the simulation box in each direction. So the first number shows the dimension of the simulation in x direction, second one shows it in y direction, and third one shows it in z direction. So that's what grow file contains usually. So we'll just close this. I hope it's clear to everyone. And then apart from the grow file, it creates a protein topology file. So we'll take a look into what exactly does this topology file contains. So I'll open it this with a text editor. You can use any text editor, Notepad. If you're using Linux, you can use Vim, or you can even if you're using Mac, you can use the text editor present in that OS. So you can use any text editor to look at this. So this is the topology file. You can see there are a lot of things here. So I'll explain one by one what is each and everything. So whenever in every line, when you see a semicolon like this here, it means it's a comment. So I think there was a question. Was there a question?
Yes, there is a question. What is the main difference between classical PDB, GRO, and topple file?
Okay, so PDB, both PDB and GRO files are coordinate files. That means they contain details about the coordinates of each and every atom of the protein. So that's all. The essential part is they contain x, y, z coordinates. So it's like different. To give you an analogy, it's like different image format. There are JPEG images, there are PNG images, and so on. They all have the same function. They show the image, but there are differences in the formatting. Different programs read different. They show the information differently. That's the only difference between PDB to GRO. In the topology is not a coordinate file. So that's the big difference between GRO file and topology, and PDB file and topology. PDB and GRO file show the coordinates of the atoms. Topology does not show the coordinates of the atoms. What topology does is it shows the chemical properties of each and every atom in the protein molecule. So these chemical properties involve masses, charge, as well as the information about bond. So I'll just give you an example. You have given a protein for MD simulation. How does the MD program know if there's a bond between two atoms? If there's a group of three atoms, if there are the three atoms connected by a bond, or let's say if there are a group of eight atoms, of those eight atoms, which of those atoms are connected by a bond, which three group of atoms among them have bond angle, which group of four atoms have torsions, and so on. So the MD program needs all these information from the topology file. So that's what the topology file contains. So I'll explain to you what exactly does topology file contains. So this is how a topology file usually looks. Whenever in case of a GROMax topology file, whenever you see a semicolon at the beginning of line, so usually in Python and shell scripts, comment is highlighted by a hashtag, right? So that means It's just a comment for us to see, or whenever someone opens this file, it's for the person who is opening that, who is reading that file. There will be information, extra information. So these are the comments. These are the extra comments added in the topology file that contains extra information. So for instance, it shows what is the which version of GROMATS was used to create the topology file. In this case, it shows 2019.4, and it also shows which command did I use to create this topology file, and so on. So there was another question, I think. Pranav, can you read me the question? I didn't catch it.
Yeah, it was not a question actually, it was a message saying like grow file is similar to the original PDB file. In particular, it contains the same information regarding the positions of atoms, but the layout is different. Hydrogens have been added and units have been converted to nanometer.
Exactly. So that's exactly the difference between the GRO and PDB file. So in the topology file, whenever you see a semicolon, that means it's a comment. So that means the GROMAX program won't read any of this. It will ignore all these lines saying that it's a comment. So in the 21st line, line number 21, we can see hashtag include. That means whenever there's a hashtag and after that there's a word include, that means you are telling GROMAX to look for another file that's present in sometimes in the same directory or sometimes in another directory. So here it's this topology file is telling GROMAX to include force field parameters. Since we are using OPLS force field, so it's telling the GROMAX program to include OPLS force field parameters. So when I say hashtag include, that means I have to give the location of the file which contains the force field parameters. In this case, it's OPLS A force field / force field dot ITP. So this is present in the GROMAX library. So wherever GROMAX is installed, when you give OPLS A dot FF, GROMAX will automatically understand that it's in the GROMAX library. So it will go to that library and it will search for the force field file. So since we are just beginning, since this is a beginner level of GROMAX, I won't go into detail what is present inside that force field file and so on. It's not completely important to, as a beginner, it's not completely important to understand what's present in those force field files. It's more advanced level stuff. So for now, we'll ignore that particular part. So after that, there's something called as molecule type. So there are different heading. One is molecule type, second is atoms, then there will be bonds, details about bonds. Yeah, there'll be one more heading that gives details about bonds. And after that, angles, and after that, dihedrals, and so on. So important part in the topology file is you need to, all these headings should be in correct order. That means molecule type should always come first, then atoms, then bonds, then angles, then dihedrals, and so on. So it's better that, I would recommend that whatever topology file GROMAX creates, it's better to leave it as it is. It's better not to touch anything. So I'll just explain what exactly are present here. Then we get to the atoms. So here it shows all the atoms present in the protein. I'm not sure what. So it shows all the atoms that are present in our protein. And in the first column, it shows the number of the atom. In every residue, there will be a heading. residue 1 lysine, there will be a corresponding name in the force field file, and there's a Q2 plus 0 means that's the charge. That's the charge of this particular residue. Then there will have details about the atoms. In the third column, there are details about the residue number, name of the residue, here the name of the atom. Then after that, charge group. So there are different charge groups for the each of the atom. Then the absolute charge as well.
Hello, Rajesh. Hello, Rajesh, you're there?
Yeah, am I audible now?
Yeah, now you're audible, yes.
So after the atoms, we'll move on to the bonds. So you can see that, so in the fourth column, there are groups of charges. So two to three different atoms are grouped according to their chemical properties. They are not the actual charge. So this is for the force field. This is for GROMax to help assigning the chemical properties to those particular atoms based on what's present in the force field. So that's the basic difference. That's all. So after the atoms, we'll move on to the bonds. We can see three columns. So in the first column, it gives the name of the first atom, and in the second column, it gives the name of the number of the second atom. So we can see that all these two numbers in the both the columns are the name of the atoms and corresponding second atom. So it's telling GROMax to consider all these pair of atoms as bonds. That's the information given in the second heading. So once we are done with the bonds, we'll move on to the pairs, which means there are interacting non-bonded interacting pairs, which represents the index of all the non-bonded interacting pairs. So it's all the number of atoms. It shows the number of atoms. So after that, so next we move on to the angles. It's same thing like the bonds, except we can see a group of three residues, a group of three atoms, which shows the angle description between the group of these three atoms. And after angles, we move on to the dihedrals, which is the same thing, except for the it's defining torsion groups for calculation of dihedral. So these are the details in a topology file. And apart from that, there's also something called as details of position restraint file. So I'll explain in the next further slides what exactly is this position restraint file. So it says, if def position restraint, that means if position restraint is asked, include posery.itp. So it's giving the location of the position restraint files and end if. It's almost like a loop. It's open the loop by saying if def posers, and end if means it's closing the loop. And after that, it's including the details for water model. Since I asked it to choose SPC model, it's including SPC model details here. And then there's additional parameters for ions. So here it's giving the details of the ions parameter file. And if you are doing simulation of a membrane protein, there will also be another line giving the topology details for membrane molecules. But here it's a soluble protein, so there's no such thing here. So in the end, we'll see two more headings. One is called system. It's the name of the system, protein in water. And at the end, there's molecules. So we can see the number of protein molecules. There's one protein molecule. Number of solvent molecules. Sol means solvent molecules, which is the water. So there are 10,636 water molecules. And there are number of chlorine ions, which is eight number here. So this is what topology file usually contains. It contains all the information regarding chemical properties for Bromax to make calculations. So
yes.
Yeah,
there is a question like, where do we find or where can we find non-bonded interaction details? Can we find in the same topological file?
So the non-bonded interactions is calculations are performed based on the force field. So if you attended the previous lecture, I showed you how are the non-bonded interactions calculated. For van der Waals interactions, van der Waals potentials are calculated based on something called as LJ potentials or Lennard-Jones potentials. So there's an equation for calculating that. So what we need for that is atom one, atom two, van der Waals radius of one of the two, both of the atoms, and the distance between the atoms. So based on this, it calculates the hydrophobic interactions. For charge interactions, we need information on the charge. The charge information is present in the topology file. We need information on the distance between the charge. And that based on these information, we can calculate Coulombic potential. So topology file does not necessarily contain explicit information on calculating non-bonded interactions. It's mainly for the bonded interactions. So once we have created a topology file, we'll move on to the further steps, which involves creating a simulation box, that is putting the protein inside a simulation box and adding the solvent. So to do that, we'll go back to the command line and we'll give one more command. So I'll give a command gmx space edit conf dash f input grow file 1aki protein dot grow dash o is output solve dot grow. So I'll give few more options here. I'll give option dash c. That means I'm telling Gromax to put the protein molecule at the center of simulation box. So that's what the dash c means. Dash d 1.0. This means I'm telling Gromax to set the box in such a way that there's minimum of 1 nanometer distance between the edge of the box and the protein. So that there's also minimum 1 nanometer distance between the periodic image of the protein. So I'll explain in the next slide what exactly is this periodic image. And after that, dash BT. BT means what shape of simulation box do I want? So for that, I'll tell cubic. So there are different types of box. There is rectangular, there's cubic, and there's orthogonal, then there's rhomboidal. So it depends on what's the shape of your protein. So in this case, cubic is the simplest type of box. So I'm giving cubic type. So I'll press enter. And it will put the box in the center. So this was a
There is a question. Yeah, there is a question.
There was a question.
Yeah,
what are the consequences of?
Yeah,
I could read
the consequences that are expected in these steps if we don't remove water molecules from the original protein.
Okay, so the water molecules in the original protein file, the water molecules, let's say the water molecules are written as HOH. So in this simulation, I'm choosing the SPC model. So if you choose the if you try to give it as it is, Gromax will give you error saying that it does not know what it can it's not able to Hello.
Yeah, continue.
Yeah, so the Gromax will give you an error saying that it's not able to recognize this particular water molecule. It's not able to recognize this particular atom itself. So since I'm given the specifying the water model, I need to put exactly the water molecules of that particular model only. I cannot put water molecules of another model. So that's why it's important to remove all the non-protein atoms before. If there are other non-protein atoms, something like detergent and all, so when we do the PDB to GMX step, Gromax will give you an error saying that it doesn't know what is this molecule. It's not able to recognize this molecule. So which is why it's important to remove all those molecules, all those non-protein molecules in the beginning itself. So I hope it's clear. So we'll move to the next step. So once we have put the protein in the center of the simulation box, then we'll add water molecules to the protein, solvent molecules. So for that, I'll give another command, gmx space solvate dash cp solve dot grow. Cp is the input coordinate file that I created in the previous step. That is, let's say, so here I'm in the third step. So whenever I'm doing the step in the Gromax, I need to use the input file of previous step as the input. I need to use the output file of previous step as input in the current step. And whatever output file I get in this step, I'll have to use that file as the input in next step. So that's how it. That's how this works in Gromax. So I'll use the sol.grow as the input and dash cs. Cs is the HPC216.grow. This is the water model that is present in the Gromax library. So it automatically knows where it is present. It doesn't have to be present in this same directory. And dash o is sol2.grow. So this is the output grow file. So does the type of can you repeat
by question? Adding water, what will it add all through or around it?
So it will add around the protein. So it makes sure that it adds the water molecule around the protein, but even if there are bad contacts between the water and protein molecules, will remove it using energy minimization.
Then the question is for me. If such error is given, and suppose we have an active site water, which we have interest to see the interactions, then how can I troubleshoot the error?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand what's the error.
So he mean to say like, what if his active site is interacting with water? So how can we study this?
Okay, so let's say your protein structure had a water molecule near the active site. In case of MD simulation, you'll just put all the water molecules as it is. We don't care whether there's an active site around or not. After putting the water molecules, we'll do MD simulation. Once we do the MD simulation, we can check the MD trajectory to see if there are any water molecules that are interacting with the active site. And or we can check if any particular water molecule is sitting at the active site for a long time. So we can look at it that way. So I hope it's clear.
Yeah, there is one more question. Mm-hmm. We explained about different box types. So
yeah,
does it influence the duration of calculation time, or what is the most recommended box type?
So it does. It actually, it's a good question. So it definitely influences the calculation time. So let's say it depends on what shape is your protein. So if your protein shape matches with the shape of the box, you don't have to spend a lot of computational time to you don't have to spend a lot of computational resource to do the calculation. But in the other end, there's a both advantage as well as disadvantage to this. If your protein shape is matches with the shape of the box, then you will save a lot of time with the calculation. But if your protein shape does not match with the shape of the box, let's say your protein is one shape and box is another shape, then there's a problem that your protein's periodic image will interact with itself. That means there may not be enough shape for the enough space for the protein to breathe around. There might be one problem. Or second problem, you need to, you might have to give a big enough box that the protein excess of computational resources will be wasted. So it depends on the what shape of your protein. So when you set the shape of the box, cubic box is a safe way. It's like a cubic box is a minimum risk way. It's like you have a cubic box, you are putting protein inside it, and you are making sure that there is enough distance for water molecules to sit as well. But you might spend extra computational resources. But if you're trying to choose other box, you need to make sure that your protein's shape is compatible with the box shape. So once you're sure of that, you can proceed with that type of box. So I hope that's clear. Okay then. So once we have solvated the protein, I'll just we'll just have a look at solvated simulation box. So it's the output file was solve2.grow. So we'll have a look at the solve2.grow using VMD program. So we'll wait for the program to open.
Can we see using PyMOL itself?
I think as far as I know, PyMOL doesn't handle grow file well. You can try, but from my experience, PyMOL doesn't handle grow file well. VMD is better for looking into the grow file. So by the time it loads, I'll explain you what are periodic boundary conditions. So periodic boundary conditions, or it's the short form is PBC. So PBC, is an assumption made in MD simulation that your system is infinite. Your protein, putting your protein and all protein and water molecules in your simulation box, but the MD program makes an assumption that system is infinite, and beyond this simulation box, there are mirror images of the same system adjacent to it. So what does this mean is that, so let's look at this diagram. So let's look at this particular red atom called R-cut. So let's say if this atom moves outside the box. So is there a way to show pointer? Just try to see if I can maybe show a pointer or draw a line. So Yeah, so can everyone see this yellow color circle I have drawn? So
Yes,
let's
yes.
say this, let's say this, we have this particular particle that's at the boundary of the box. So if this particle moves out of the simulation box, then there will be a mirror image of the same particle that will come from the opposite direction. So if this moves here, I'll try to do this again. Yeah. So if this moves here,
your pointer is visible to this.
Okay. So if this particle moves here, the mirror image of this particle will come here. So in that sense, the mirror image of the particle will have exact velocities and exact force acting on it. So there's a continuation, there's a sense of continuity of the simulation. If the particle goes out of simulation box, you can get a mirror image in the opposite direction. So that's what the concept PBC means. So we'll check on the, yeah. So I hope the VMD screen is visible. So this is the protein box. So you can see the protein is in blue color and all the water ions are in red and white color. So I can go to the representations. So I can type protein. So it shows the protein. So I choose a different method. So this is the protein and I'll show the water molecules. There's name Sol. Yeah. So this is the simulation box. This is the simulation box. You can see that it's cuboidal and the proteins, there's a protein with the water surrounding it. So
there is a question, like, so you spoke about PBC condition. So there are like, I have one doubt, like what will happen if the PBC condition is not maintained? There is a one more follow-up question, like can you explain a bit about PBC, where it is applied during the simulation?
So coming to the first question, there's a when we before we run the MD simulation, we need to specify if we want to apply PBC or not. So if we say yes, then the simulation program will automatically apply PBC by itself throughout the simulation. So there's no question of whether the PBC periodic boundary condition is not applied suddenly. So if we give the option of applying PBC conditions, then the GROMax will automatically apply, make sure the PBC is applied throughout the simulation. And coming to the second question, so the point of can you repeat the second question?
Where exactly the PBC condition is applied during the simulation?
So I'm not sure if I understood the question right, because where exactly if it's applied means it's applied to the simulation box itself.
Yeah, like how that condition helps in the simulation, if you put the question that way.
So let's say you have this, let's assume that this molecule, this particle I explained is the protein. So if the protein drifts away from the system, then there's a problem that if the protein, let's say, drifts away from the system, you lost the image of the protein. So there's it's to account for the translation of the box. So In a real life, the protein is free to diffuse anywhere. I mean, let's say if the protein is in cytoplasm, it can diffuse anywhere. it's not it's there's no guarantee that it will remain restrained in its position all the time. It's free to diffuse anywhere. But in the MD simulation, we don't have an infinite, we don't have a very large simulation box, so which is why even if the protein drifts away, we can assume that there's a mirror image of that protein coming back from another direction. So there's a, even if the protein goes out of the box, the continuity of the simulation will be maintained. So that's why PPC is important. So I hope it's clear. So
thank you.
Yeah. So we'll just, this is how the simulation box usually looks. The red and white particles are water molecules. I'll give a different representation. Let's say van der Waals. Yeah. So these are the water molecules, and surround the water molecules is surrounding the protein. So this is how our system, MD system looks like. But so we have created a protein with water. We have created a proper system to do MD simulation. But is it enough? The answer is no, because there still could be charges on the protein. There, we need to make sure that our system has a net neutral charge. So for that, we need to add ions to the system. So let's say our system has total of plus 5 positive charges. We need to add 5 negative charges. That is, we need to add 5 number of ions so that the system remains neutral. So for that, we'll do another command. So for this, we need something called as MDP file. MDP file means it's a file that contains all the parameters we need to do this particular step. So I've given the link where can we find this MDP file. So you can download, you can use this link and you can download this MDP file. You can just open it with a text editor. I'll just try give the command here, gmx go mpp f ion.mdp, that's the parameter file, e topol.top. So this is the topology file I showed you before, c sol2.grow, that's the input file, solvated system, output ion.ppr. So this GrowMPP, it just prepares the system for adding ions. So this is more like a preparation step for adding ions. So I'll give the command. Okay. So I think there was an error here. Yeah. So I did a mistake in the previous step. The mistake I did was, in the previous step, I did not give the topology file. In the when we are solvating, we need to give the topology file as well, so that it updates the amount of, whenever we add the water in it, that water should be updated in the topology file as well. So since I didn't do that, it will giving me an error that says that in the grow file there are certain number of particles, but in topology file there are different number of particles. It's not tallying. So we need to do the previous step again. So I will add the topology file dash p topol.top. Okay. Now we will try.
Rajas.
Yeah.
So before we move on to the next step, like there is a question. Since this lecture is focused on basics, but there is a question with this outside, like, is the parameter same for all protein ligand complexes too? If not, how to define? If you want, you can answer it now, or we will reserve for the next session.
So do you mean the parameters
complex wise? Yeah, protein ligand complex.
You mean the parameters for simulation parameters or force field?
I think she means simulation parameters.
Simulation parameters, it's usually the same. It's there are very little differences. Simulation parameters, it's usually very, there are usually little, very little differences. There are differences, but it depends on the situation. But normally it's the same.
Okay.
So we'll try grow MPP step again. Yeah, now it's working fine. So you can see that it's important to mention the topology file as well, so that it updates the number of molecules. So once we are done with the grow MPP step, we'll do GMX space genion dash s ion.tpr, which is the output of the previous step. Output as sys.grow, system.grow, p.stopol.top again, because we have to update when we are adding the ions, we need to update it in topology file as well. P name means name of the proton, what type of protons I need to add. In this case, I'll say Na, which means sodium. I will add sodium. N name means name of the anion. Here I'll add Cl, which means chlorine. So I'll be adding sodium chloride. And here I'll add neutral, dash neutral. That means, so here I'm not saying how many ions to add. I'm just saying, I don't know how many ions to add, just make it neutral for me. So GrowMax will check the total charge of the system. Let's say if the total charge of the system is plus 10, then it will add minus 10 chlorine ions. If the total charge is plus 2, it will add minus 2 chlorine ions. So that's how it will neutralize. Or if you don't, apart from neutral, if you need to add a certain amount of salt, let's say 0.1 molar of salt, you can add that as well. But you need to make sure that the system is neutral. So in this case, we'll just try with neutral. So it's asking, select a continuous group of solvent molecules. So it's asking me which one is the water here. So there are different groups: system, protein, C alpha, backbone, and so on. The water is group number 13, which is a salt. So I'll type 1, 3. So what it does is it selects specific water molecules, and it will replace those water molecules with a chlorine ion. So in this case, it has done that 8 times. So 8 chlorine ions are added by replacing 8 water molecules. And it replaces the topology, it updates the topology file as well. So once we are done with this genion step, we'll move on to the energy minimization step. So I'll explain you what exactly is energy minimization. So before we do a simulation, it's important to remove steric clashes or bad contacts in the system. That means there could be a possibility that your protein structure is not a good resolution structure. That means there could be a possibility that two or three atoms of the protein are present in the same position or overlapping. So because of that, there will be steric clashes. And or let's say when I was adding ions and water, some of the water molecules may have come in place of the protein. That means there will be overlap of both of these. So that again is a bad contact or steric clashes. So to remove all these things, we'll do energy minimization. So what happens in energy minimization is, so we'll start with the system. We'll calculate potential energy of the system. So, and the particle that has got highest potential energy is calculated. So then we will give a small push. We'll give a small push to the small displacement to the particle that has highest potential energy, and we'll recalculate the potential energy. So then we'll give a small push so that the potential energy is decreased. That's the important part here. We'll make sure that whenever the particle is displaced to a small extent, that should result in a lower potential energy. So then after that, we'll recalculate the potential energy. We'll see if it's lower or higher. We'll again give a small push and again calculate the potential energy and so on and so forth. So we'll repeat these steps for several hundred or thousands times until there's a until we reach a local minimum. So if you have studied protein thermodynamics, you can or the protein energy landscape theory,
Rajas.
Hello, am I audible now?
Yeah, now you are audible. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So we'll bring the protein to the local minima where it's the energy is low, but it's not at the state. It's not at the most stable state. So in mathematical terms, we can describe it with this equation, where R n plus 1 is new set of coordinates, R n is the initial coordinates of the system, F n is the total potential energy, max F n is the total highest potential energy on a particular particle. That is, it's the particular potential energy of the particle that has highest energy. And HN is a scaling factor that's determined by Gromyk's program. So this is the basic concept of energy minimization. So we'll do the energy minimization now. So we'll give the command gmx space grow mpp dash f minim dot mpp minimization dot mpp. So this is again the parameter file for minimization. So you can download the parameter file from this particular link that's shown here. Yeah. So you can download the parameter file from this link. If you have a copy of presentation, then it will be even more easier to download. So give minim.mdp dash p topol.top topology file dash c is the input coordinate file system.grow dash o is the em.pdf. So I'll briefly show you what's present in the minimization input file. So if you look at the bottom of the screen, this is what this minimization input file contains. So the first four parameters are most important. So first is the type of integrator. So there are different methods to do the minimization. One is called so there was a question called if minimization is meant to remove steering clashes, we can do with if you can perform with external applications. So
many tools are there.
Yeah, so I think it's possible to perform. I'm pretty sure it's possible to perform, but I'm not sure if the other tools will handle so many coordinates. That means you have in this particular case, in this lysozyme is a small protein. In this system, we have 30,000 atoms. 30,000, or I'll just check how many atoms do we have. So there are 33,892 atoms. So I'm not sure if those programs will be able to handle this many number of atoms. So I'm not completely sure about it. So Gromyk can efficiently handle this much number of atoms. It can handle with it has enough memory allocation so that it can handle this many atoms without any problem. But other programs, I'm not completely sure about it. So We'll get back to the slide. So the integrator is a method. Which method do I want to follow? Steepest descent is the most commonly used method. There are other methods as well. I won't mention them here for the sake of simplicity. I mean, if you're interested, you can look into the GROMAT's energy minimization methods. EM toll is 1000 kilojoules per mole. That means whenever we'll keep on doing minimization until the maximum force maximum force on a particular particle is not more than 1000 kilojoules per mole. So when the maximum force attains this number, that's when GROMAX will tell stop the minimization. So there's a question, if possible can you show where you can find. So I showed you the grow file, right? Just open the grow file, read the second line. The number you get is the total number of atoms of the system. So if you want the absolute size of the system, you need to go to the bottom of the grow file. There are three coordinates. One is the X, Y, and Z coordinate. So that will give you the dimension of the simulation box. That's the answer to this question, I hope. So EM step is 0.01. That's the minimization step size. So if we look back to this particular equation, the Rn is the, that's the Rn. Rn is determined by this particular parameter, EM step. And N steps. N steps is how many steps do I need to perform? These are the four most important parameters. Other parameters are, I think they are too advanced for this particular class. If you are interested, you can just look up this parameter. I mean, look up for what do they mean. So we'll try the GROMPP step. Now, if the time limit is getting too late, maybe you can let me know, because we are not even halfway. So if the time limit is up, you can let me know. I can continue this in the next session.
Yeah, sure. I think we can. I'll let you know.
Yeah. So because energy minimization, I think it will take at least 2 to 3 minutes minimum. And after that equilibration, it will take half an hour or so. So this will be time consuming. So once we have done the GROMPP, so we have completed the GROMPP step. After that, we'll do another step called GMX MD run. So I'll type GMX space MD run. I'll type GMX space MD run dash DEFFNN space EM dash V. So now it starts the minimization.
So Rajas, we can you can explain the energy minimization, and then the overview of like summary of what we did today. Then we can wind for today, like till energy minimization.
Sure. So I'll explain the energy minimization again. So I'll get back to this slide. So before we do a simulation, it's important to remove the steric clashes and bad contacts in the system. So its energy minimization is exactly done for that. So what happens in energy minimization is we calculate total potential energy of the system, and we calculate the particle on which there is highest amount of force or highest amount of potential energy. Because the force is negative gradient of potential energy, we calculate the both the same things. Then we'll give a small push to this particular particle. Then we'll recalculate the potential energy again. We'll give a push so that the steric clashes are eliminated and the particle with highest. So when it's displaced to a small distance, we'll recalculate the energies for the system. So we'll keep on doing this again and again and again, so that the whole system reaches an energy minimum. That is, the system is stable enough to start a simulation. So this is exactly what happens in the energy minimization. So once we done with the energy minimization, we can move ahead to the further steps, and I'll just summarize what we have done so far. So in the first step, we'll take a protein, we'll remove all the non-protein particles, then we'll prepare the system using PDB to GMX command. We'll also assign a particular force field. In this case, we chose OPLS force field. Then we'll put the protein in a simulation box. We'll put the protein inside a simulation box, and then we'll add water molecules. After water molecules, we'll add ions to make sure the system is neutral. And after that, we'll do energy minimization. So unfortunately, because of, so now we can see that the energy minimization is finished here. So you can see that it's giving some messages. The system has given message. So we can see there is something called as EPOT. That means it's a potential, this is the potential energy of the system. So it shows what's the maximum potential energy now. It's -3 × 10⁵. So it's already in the negative side. That means there's already low potential energy. You can see that the potential energy decreases from -3 to -5.8. So you can see that there's a clear reduction in the overall potential energy, so that it attains a local minimum. So we'll just have a look into the minimize system, which is em.grow. So meanwhile, if anyone has any more questions, maybe you can ask me.
Hello, participants can type your queries in the chat box. Do you have any queries so far in the steps to prepare MD? So Rajas, I have a question, like what happens if the system is not maintained neutral?
So you can proceed further without doing the keeping it neutral, but the problem is it introduces a bias into the system. That means when there's a charge in the protein, you're introducing a bias into your calculations. So that will, your whatever results you might, whatever observations you will make from the MD, would not, it may not be experiment, it may not be physiologically valid. Because we need to remember that the protein essentially exists in a buffer. That buffer, it's the pH is, that particular environment is ensured. So if there's an excessive concentration of charges in one or other direction, then the environment around the protein is disturbed. So whatever physiological proteins we want to see in a protein, that those physiological properties may not be realistic. So I hope that I've answered your question.
Yes.
So this is how the energy minimize system looks like. So it's very hard to tell the difference between the file I showed before and now, but if there are too many overlapping atoms and or so on, it would be easier to visualize, it would be easier to identify where the changes were taking place. So one important thing with the MD simulation is, after every step, after minimization, after adding ions and so on, it's very important that we have to visualize our system once using VMD. So it's very important to do that. With that, by looking at the system itself, we can tell if there's a serious problem with the system. Because if we don't visualize, we won't be able to know if the system is okay or if there's something wrong with the system.
Okay, Rajesh. There is a question which is like, what are the common pitfalls or mistakes while doing MD?
Okay, so that's a very good question, but I think it would be even more nice if I explain it in the next session. So far I have not covered the equilibration and MD simulation part. So in the next session we will be covering on those, and in the next session it will be you'll be able to understand better what sort of mistakes do we usually make. So
there is a question from YouTube. A person has asked, like, he doesn't have a protein structure from PDB, so can he do dynamic simulation, he's asking.
So there one option is that you can model the protein, so you can create a homology model of the protein, but there's a big condition. The condition is that the protein structure in which you are interested in and in which you don't have a structure, it should have very good similarity with another protein structure. Let's say if your protein has at least 50% similarity, 50 or 60% identity with another protein whose structure is available, then okay, it's a reasonable model, and you can create a homology model of that protein and you can try simulation on that. But if the identity is less than, let's say, 40% or even 30%, then it's not safe to do a modeling of that particular protein. There was another question. I'll try to.
Yes, there is another question. What all attributes of your protein input fails the PDB to GMX command?
Okay, so let's say if you have a non-protein molecule that you don't have any particular force field parameters for, then it will give you a failure. So it will give you a failure saying that the PDB to GMX does not recognize this particular non-protein molecule. So it's important that you remove all the non-protein atoms around the in the system. So you need to make sure that there are only the proteins. Only proteins are present when you're doing PDB to GMX. And there's one more question, that additional info about unknown protein for MD. Also, if model has non-standard residue,
it's recommended to do parameterization.
Okay, parameterization is very difficult. I mean, so personally, I would not recommend to do parameterization for a beginner, if you're a beginner. When you do parameterization, you need to create a model of the molecule, you need to do the simulation, and you need to look at a certain type of property, and you need to compare the same property what's observed from the experiments of the same molecule, and you need to do trial and error to make sure the parameters of your MD simulation matches with parameters of experiment. So if you're a beginner, it will be very, very, very difficult to do parameterization. So if it does not have a standard residue, then first thing you need to do is you need to check in Google if there are parameters available for that particular molecule, because there are decent chances that someone else has created a parameters and you can use that parameters.
If the structure contains multiple chain, will it work?
Yeah, you can do it. So, but the problem is, if you have, see, multiple chains and large protein complexes have, the proteins themselves have thousands, hundreds of thousands of atoms, or let's say lakhs of atoms. So the computational resources will be very high. So if you want to do that with just a PC with your personal computer, or let's say with the let's say even with a computer machine that has, let's say, 16 cores, even with 16 or 32 cores, I think it's difficult. We need large clusters or even supercomputers to do simulations of large protein complexes. So that's a, so you can do multiple chain or protein complexes, but there will be a lot of complexities as well. You need to be careful about those things, and there will be a lot of computational resources required for that. So I hope.
Is there any more questions? There is a question.
Two small chain of 10 amino acids, how they interact. Okay, so if you have two small chain of 10 amino acids, they are essentially peptides.
Yes.
So you can try MD simulations. It depends on how powerful your computer is. So it's you can try it out if you have a powerful enough computer. But let's say if you have a laptop of that has 4 cores, then it might be difficult. So, but still you can try it out if you're curious.
So, hey, Murali, can you explain like what you mean by two small chains? It's a single protein with.
He's referring to a peptide, I guess. Maybe he wants to study interaction of two different peptides, perhaps.
So actually, I just thought of it just like that. I wanted to know if two small chain are there, can I study its interaction? Just like that, I just made it.
If you are interested in doing MD on actual proteins, but if you don't have computational resources, then you can try. There are MD simulation servers available. I think LLB group, people in LLB group has more information. I know there are servers, but I'm not completely aware of which exact servers and all. But you can try with those servers, actually.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
No problem. So I hope all the questions are answered.
No questions. End this session by thanking Rajat for his time and his patience in answering all the questions.
Thank you, Pranav, as well.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Pranav, and thank you to all the audience who are for listening to the talk. Thank you.